In this lesson, we're going to look at catalysts, what they are and how they work in chemical reactions, dealing with kinetics or rates at which reactions take place. So what is a catalyst? It is a substance that increases the rate of a reaction, makes it take place faster without being consumed. So you have to put it in there, it gets used in some way, but when it's all said and done, it is all still there. It doesn't get consumed, it's not part of the reactant or the product. Well, it's not a reactant, okay? So what it does is, in the mechanism, and you got these steps that you're looking at in your mechanism, it gets used in one of the steps to speed up, typically, the slowest rate determining step, okay? So it is going to be consumed in one of the steps in the mechanism, and so it gets used up. And then in another subsequent step, it'll be regenerated. And so overall, it's not being used as you look at the overall reaction. So what it's doing is it's giving a totally different mechanism to get from reactants to products. You start with your reactants, you go to products. But in that mechanism, it's giving you a different route to those products, and that route has a lower mountain to climb. It has a lower activation energy. So here are examples of a energy diagram. On the left, we see the uncatalyzed form, okay? So the activation energy, it's tall. When you add the catalyst, we see a lower activation energy. Now, the delta H is the same either way, because remember, delta H is just between here and here. So that's your delta H. The enthalpy change. From here to here is the delta H, the enthalpy change. So that's not changing, but the mountain that has to be climbed from reactants to products is different for the catalyzed versus the uncatalyzed reaction. So there's three general types of catalysts. You've got your heterogeneous, you've got your homogeneous catalyst, and you've got your biological catalyst, which is an enzyme. Let's take a brief moment to look at each one of these types. Okay, the heterogeneous versus the homogeneous catalyst has to do with what state it's in, okay? So they're simply defined by the state. If it's heterogeneous, then it's in a different phase than the reactants. And here is a really good example. In your car is a catalytic converter. This is a solid mesh of actually pretty expensive metals, okay? So we've got this mesh that the gas, and I don't mean gasoline, I mean the fumes from the engine will pass through. So they are in the gas state. Your exhaust from your car will pass through that and enable them to fully oxidize. So since this is a solid mesh, it's in a different phase than the gas state that's passing through. On the other hand, homogeneous, we know what homogeneous means, it's uniform throughout, so they're all in the same phase. So if you have an aqueous solution and your catalyst dissolves into the water as well, then you've got yourself a homogeneous catalyst. So that's the difference between homogeneous and heterogeneous and how they operate. The enzyme is the biological catalyst. That's what takes place within your body or any living system. They're usually very, very large, complex molecules. They are proteins, typically, with molar mass in the thousands of grams per mole. So, if you're an enzyme, anything that we learn about catalysts applies to an enzyme. I want to show you just an image. Each one of the little bumps on there would be a different atom within this enzyme. So this is a very, very large enzyme with lots and lots of atoms in it. And we're not going to get into the workings of an enzyme. I'm sure if you go on and take a biochemistry class, you will learn about how enzymes operate. There is one last thing I want to mention about a catalyst that I thought I had an image of in my PowerPoint, but let me go to the light board here and just kind of talk a little bit about how they would show up in a mechanism. Let's imagine, I'm just making this up on the fly, so let's have A plus B going to, let's say, 2C, And then let's take the 2C, no, not 2C, let's just take a C, one of my C's, and have it bump into another A, making it up as I go, and that is going to make B plus D. Okay, so I just made something up there. What do we got going on here? Ah, can't do that. Let's do this. This is where you're at risk when you make it up on the fly. Okay, so, no, that would have worked. We'll go back to it. All right, so what do we got going on here? Let's look at what can be canceled. Notice how there is a B on this side that could cancel with the B on this side, okay? And one of these C's can cancel with one of these C's and leave one behind. And what you end up with is 2A going to C plus D. Okay, now, which one of these things up here would be a catalyst? Now, we have to remember what a catalyst is. It is being used in one step and regenerated in a subsequent step, but it doesn't show up in the overall reaction. So, which substance is being used in one step and regenerated in another step? Well, that would be B. See, it's being consumed here, but in this step, it's coming back out again. Now, they're canceling because they're on opposite sides of the reaction, but you had to put B in order for the reaction to be catalyzed in that step, but it gets regenerated, okay? Now, what substance is, I don't even want to call it an intermediate. There is a C that's an intermediate getting used up here, but some of the C is staying behind. So, don't know if that ever actually happens, but I really wanted to show you the order of why things show up if you're going to recognize them as being a catalyst. All right, so we've looked through it all of the catalysts, and this actually ends our whole section on kinetics.